and enjoy.
Thank you very much, Josh. I have a special thank you to the Sanders, Mr. and Mrs. Sanders, for having us here on Melava Malka in Motzei Shabbat. And we had a beautiful Shabbaton. I spoke already in 3 different shul. I'm only here 24 hours. I came to work here, Baruch Hashem. Ofer is a commando chief.
A warrior.
A warrior. He doesn't play games. He made a schedule, Baruch Hashem. That's the way I like it. I was also in Istanbul. I spoke from the morning to the night straight. And then when we're done, we had the Melava Malka like this in someone's house. The people were very thirsty for Torah over there. Not that many opportunities they have to have a speaker with them the whole Shabbat. So it was also beautiful. Well, I would speak about different things. You know, if you know me, then I never have a topic. Even if I say that I have a topic, I don't really have. Well, after I speak 5 minutes, I find myself in a different street. So it's normal. I would encourage you to ask me questions, you know. The more questions you ask, the better the lectures will get. I'm sure you will finally have some questions when I start to talk. Today, we have, in a Jewish world, we have like 13.2 million people only. In a world of 7.4 billion people, we are only a drop of a drop. We less than 0.02% in the world. 0.02%. You know what it means? You take 1% of the world and divide it by 50. That's really the amount of the Jews in the world. Not 1% of the world, a 50th of a percent. 2% of 1%. You got the point? And that's the little few crumbs that fell from the big cake. They run the whole world. You know, many of the enemies of the Jewish nation, they have a lot of complaints. One of the complaints in America, in England, in France, in many other successful countries, Germany, whatever, they always claim that the Jews run the economy. It drives them crazy. But reality shows that only when the Jews ran the economy, those countries were very successful. As soon as the Jews were kicked out, the country collapsed. Look in Iran, what happened. When the Shah was in power, the Jews were in power, they ran the country, they were one of the richest countries in the world. They kicked the Jews out, they took away their property, and what happened to them? Nothing. They became very poor and people dying from starvation there. And they went 1,000 years back in history. That's how primitive it got there. And were like Paris. If people know Tehran and the days before the Islam took over and they kicked the Jews out. There was a wonderful place, like heaven on this world. That's the way the old Persian described Iran in the time of the Shah. They came over, they kicked the Jews. Same thing Russia. It's a very strong empire. They kicked the Jews out, they collapsed. The price of a fish went 100 times higher overnight. It was $3, jumped to $300 the next day. The ruble, from $5 to $1, went to $500 to $1 overnight. Which means if you had $100 million when you went to sleep, you woke up in the morning with $1 million only. I don't have to tell you what happened to a country when it happens. It used to be in the old days, Abarbanel, Don Yitzhak Abarbanel, it was the treasury of Spain. He was in charge of the money. They did very well. The priests, in those days, the church had very strong power and control of the country. They used to have a lot of, they used to complain a lot. So one time they decided to make a declaration, how much a person has. They saw that Abarbanel is very wealthy. He has a beautiful home and lots of money. He's in charge of all the money. So they started to accuse him that he's stealing, he's doing all kinds of things. So they wanted to make a declaration. So everyone has to write how much he has. Now everyone knew his house in those days, it's like $3 million today, let's say. So he wrote in the declaration that his total net worth is $250,000. And when everyone sees his house, they already know it's worth millions. So he served it to the king. So everyone wrote $2 million, $5 million, $7 million. All the people in charge of Spain in those days, they were an empire. Spain was the empire. The Jews were living in Spain. Why you say Sfaradi? Sfaradi Jews, all the Middle Eastern Jews, they call Sfaradi. Why? What's the connection between them and Sfarad? Because the Jewish community lived in Sfarad, like they live in America today. Sfarad was the America. And then from there they ran to Iran, to other countries. So he said to the king, here is my declaration. So they said, oh, finally he caught the Jew. Now we see what's his excuse going to be. So he said, the king called him and said, listen, you know I'm your friend and I appreciate what you have done for this country. But you have to be kidding here. Are you fooling us in my face? We all know your house. Just your house alone worth 5-10 times more than what you wrote. So he told him, you ask me how much I have. And I told you how much I have. You know, so he said to him, what do you mean? He said, a person according to where I come from, he only has what he gave charity. Everything else, it's not his really. It belongs to God. Whatever I gave, it's mine. Why? Because I wire it to my next world. So you ask me how much I gave. I wrote to you how much I have. This is my net worth. Everything that I have now, tomorrow somebody will tell a story about me. You take it over. You put me in jail. You kill me. So it's not really mine. I use it as I live. Do I know tomorrow I'll have it? This, by the way, you should know. When I was in Belgium, one of the diamond dealers there told me that everyone there is depressed and upset. I say, why? He said, the United States government, the IRS, they got from the Swiss banks the list of all the people who hide money there. They have a lot of money they wire there over the years. So they forced the Swiss bank, if you don't give us the list of all the people, which basically more than half of them are Jews, if you don't give us the list, we'll take your permit and you won't be able to do business in America. So the Swiss bank had no choice. They gave them the list. And they shared the list with some European governments, which means every person who saved money, 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 I don't know, they think they're going to live here forever. All of a sudden now, the United States government going after each one of them and take away all the money. So they worked 30, 40 years. In the end, they left with nothing. Now imagine the pain that they have now after their money got taken away and they're going to jail for 20, 30 years, each one of them. What do you think the first thing comes to their mind after it happens? First thing comes to their mind, if they have some fear from God, some fear, is how many rabbis came to me to beg me, save my yeshiva, it's collapsing. Save my orphanage home, it's collapsing. Save the widow with 11 children that her husband died and I never gave anything. Now they came, they took away everything I have. The first thing comes to a person's mind, at least I would give it to all these miserable people. Now who took it? Who? People who hate us. They took the money. Same thing in Europe, what do you think? We live here today, history will show us. 1-2 bad months, everyone has to get up and run. There's no certainty to the Jew ever in a history. All the nations look alike. Chinese, look at all the Chinese. The Chinese know to tell the difference between one another. I do not know. When I see 100 Chinese people, for me they all look like twins. I don't know, I really don't know. I see them, they all look alike. Very similar, straight black hair, same eyes, same all skinny. Usually they show, they are much like twins. You look at the Scandinavia, also almost the same. Everyone blonde, blue eyes, almost everyone the same. You go to some countries, you see almost everyone looks the same. The Jews look like everyone. Blonde Jew, Chinese Jew from Hong Kong, Russian Jew, Arab Jew, you know, with the curly hair, with the mustache. It looks mamash almost like all the nations. Why is it? Why Jews look like everywhere? They have a blonde Jew and a black Jew and they're brothers. They came from the same family. How can it be? Black completely and completely blonde? They two brothers? They came from the same parents? How can it be? The answer is, about 120 years ago, the scientific world discovered that the genes of a person is affected by the air that he breathes. But very, very little, not a lot. In a life of 70, 80 years, you won't see a difference on a person. It may get lighter or may get darker, but not very, very minor change. But over 6, 7, 10 generations, without intermarry the people of the place, just him and his family. After many generations, few hundred years, the children will become either lighter or darker, depend on the place. If they move to Africa, slowly, slowly, after hundreds of years, they will become darker and darker and darker until they become like the Ethiopian Jews. Because how they became black? If your father, the original father, was white, everyone should have been white. If he's black, everyone should have been black. Cannot be black give birth to white, or white gives birth to black. Something doesn't make sense here. So it makes perfect sense. The Zohar, the Kabbalah, 2,000 years ago, it writes that the people look in a certain image in their face according to the continent that they live in. The Zohar said 2,000 years ago, that's before science discovered that the air is actually, that we breathe, affecting our genes. The Zohar writes it that the people look according to the place where they live. That's why in China everyone has the same color of skin. And if they would move to a place and they live there 500 years, that's it. They're going to change. Slowly, slowly they will change. Without mixing with any other kind of different kind of people. So it's very interesting. The Jews, because they're spread all over the world and they never have a rest. If the Jews live in a place for 50, 100 years, it looks like a lot. It's already 4 or 5 generations. So you say, oh, Baruch Hashem, we're already here 100 years in this country. But that's nothing in history. What? You can establish yourself 200, 300 years, and then they one day come and they take everywhere. Like in the Spanish Inquisition, the Jews in Spain and in Portugal, they were the wealthiest in history. They're all big doctors, big philosophers. One day they come, they say, either you become Christian or we torture you. And they started to torture them, and then they kick them out, and then they kill them. They were torturing them. And then what happened? They scattered all over the world. Same thing in Russia, pogrom one after the other. And then in every other country, on and off, by the Muslim country. You have 20, 30 years that the king is good, one incident, all the Muslims goes on the street, riots, same thing. We saw in Germany what happened. This is a constant history of the Jewish people. The Torah says, if you don't listen to me, I will make the Gentiles chase you and not give you one moment of rest. You live with fear, with constant fear. Why? Because you're breaking the covenant that we made in Mount Sinai. Even when they're not chasing you, you will always live with the fear. Maybe somebody will attack me next. The Torah says clearly, clear words. I did not write the Torah. I always say if I would write the Torah, I would give a lot of discounts to the people. Because I see what they do, what they don't do. I would say, you know what, this one doesn't apply. This one doesn't apply. Here, 50% off, 80% off. You know, I would make it a lot easier for the people to keep. Maybe more people would start finally to keep. Because there are many people who admit 100% that Torah is divine, but they don't want to keep. They don't want to keep. Why? They prefer to lose their life of eternity in the afterlife for driving the car 1 hour on a Sabbath. That's their choice. What can you do? What can you do to a person like this? Person that is ignorant. He never heard Judaism. He never heard Torah. He doesn't know if the Torah is from God or not. He was raised like a non-Jew in a public school with non-Jewish people. They taught him all kinds of Shakespeare and all kinds of other things, but he never really had a chance to learn Torah. He doesn't know what Gemara is. He doesn't know what... He never read the Chumash once in his life. Believe it or not, 99.9% of the secular Jews in the world, including Israel, never read the Torah once in their lifetime. Not even once. Not only in Europe, France, places that, you know, Judaism was not so strong. Inside Israel, an average, typical Israeli now, you don't have to believe me, go make your own survey. Ask, take 100 secular Israelis and ask them, connect them to a lie detector. Did you ever read the Torah once in your life from the beginning to the end, just to understand the simple meaning of the words? Forget about all the secrets and all the midrashim. Just a simple understanding. Almost no, I never found in 19 years that I speak one chiloni, one secular Jew that read the Torah once in his life. Not even one. And I ask that hundreds of times in my lectures, and my lectures, as just said before, it's going to 120 countries, and there are many, many Jews all over the world who listens to it, and not once I got an email, I read the Torah from A to Z, and I still don't want to keep. I know I don't get this kind of emails. All of them admit that we never read the Torah. I'm saying to myself like this, if I had a way to educate all the Jewish people what the Torah is, which means all the Jewish nation would come to a seminar of 1 week, that's it, 1 week, about 6-7 lectures per day for 1 week, that's it. I have no doubt in my mind that the 13.2 million Jews that have about 2.5 million of them that observe the commandments would jump right away to 7-8 million in 1 week, with no hesitation in my mind whatsoever that that will be the case. Why? From experience. You know, you have the Gemara says, "En chacham ela kebal nisayon." Experience is even greater than wisdom. You can be a wise guy without, you can learn in medical school and get 100 in every one of your tests, but you never practice any surgery. And then you have a friend that he got only 70 in each one of his tests. He became a doctor, but he worked already 6 months in a surgery room. Who would you want, God forbid, if we need somebody in our family to be operated, who would you want to operate on a relative? The one who got 100 in every one in his test in a medical school but never spent a minute in a surgery room? Or the one who got 70 but is already working 6 months in the surgery room? Which one you would want?
70%.
Well, I don't think one person in the world would take the risk with the guy who knows everything by heart from the book but never held a scissor in his hand. Doesn't know how to cut even. You know what I mean? He has to learn. Just that he knows everything. Okay, so what's the point I'm making? I have experience. Many people want to criticize what I say, but they don't have experience because they never dealt with hundreds of thousands of people over the years. They don't answer 300 emails a day. They don't see what's happening in the Jewish world. They know a little bit. They have a Jewish friend here, Jewish friend there, some parents. So they know very little, and they already jump to conclusion, and they think they understand. They don't understand. Most of the Jews are not religious, not because they're evil, not because they have bad personality. Not necessarily. It's not the case. Most of them are not religious because they have no idea whatsoever what Judaism is. They don't understand that how many secular people, they know that the Torah can be proven scientifically as a divine book. How many? Most of the secular people think it's religion, it's a matter of faith. It's a matter of faith. You have to believe, like the Christians always say. You have to believe. But that's not what the Torah says. The Torah says if you're a believer only, you're on a very, very low level. Believing means not knowing. You have to know I'm your God. You have to know. Not knowing means 100%. You have to know I took you out of Egypt. You have to know I'm watching you every second of your life. You have to know that when you die, I will judge you for 1 year for good and bad, depending on what you did. You have to know just because you can do whatever you want right now doesn't mean I agree with you. Just because you're going to steal and I help you and I supply you with oxygen and I give you the mind how to break the safe and how to run away and how not to get caught doesn't mean I agree with your actions. I gave you free choice. You're not an animal. The animals live by instinct. They don't choose. They are programmed. They see fire, they run. They see water, they jump in. They see food, they attack. You cannot tell the lion, excuse me, Mr. Lion, can you leave the zebra alone 5 minutes until we finish to take pictures? There's no way. If he's hungry, he will attack the zebra. There's no way to stop him. There's no way. What are you going to tell him? Wait 5 minutes. Let us finish take pictures and then attack him. With a person, he can do it. He's very hungry. Don't touch the food yet. Why? We don't have water to wash our hands yet. Wait 10 minutes until the water arrives. The person can think. Do I want to wait? I don't want to wait. I'm dying to eat, but I know it's not the right thing to do. A person can analyze, can decide. The animals live with instinct. The Torah says to us, we are different than the animals. Mutar ha'adam min ha'behemah. The Torah says like this. Mutar comes from the word itaron in Hebrew. Itaron means advantage. We don't have any leverage, any advantage whatsoever from the animals at all. Except one thing. That's it. They better, they faster, they jump higher, they stronger, they healthier. Everything you want, they better than us. What is the advantage that we have? the Gemara says, besides, the only advantage that we have is that we have a divine soul that will be judged when we die. That's what it says, in front of the King of all kings, which is God. I want to ask you a question. What kind of advantage is that? Do you know one person who likes to go to court to be judged? What kind of, even to sue someone, it's horrible. If you could get 80% of the money without the headache of going to court, most people would take it. Who wants to go and stand and fight and argue and all day be stressed for months? Just give me 80% and leave me alone. No, most normal people would rather. Who wants to be judged? Nobody. That's a fact. Nobody likes to be judged. Even a little criticism people don't like. Imagine they have to be judged in front of a judge, in a jury, whatever. So what kind of advantage is that? It's a disadvantage. Look, the lion can do whatever he wants. He lay on a safari all day. He doesn't worry. Doesn't have to get up in the morning. Doesn't have to stand 30 years to work to buy a house. Maybe he can afford a mortgage. It doesn't have traffic 4 hours to get to work back and forth in New York, bumper to bumper. He doesn't suffer anything. No vaccines, no surgeries, no hardly anything. If he's a secular person that you ask him, tell me why you came to America from Israel. So what is the answer? I came for business and for pleasure. Business means Israel doesn't have so much opportunities like New York. New York can make big money if he's successful. So what is, okay, so that's one reason. What's the other reason? Let's say you're already wealthy. You're wealthy in Israel. Why you came to New York? For pleasure. What's for him pleasure? Pleasure you can have everywhere. Pleasure means women, clubs, meet people, parties. That's what he means. Some people, it's more than that. But that's the main thing, why people go and they want to come and make scenes. For them, it's the pleasure, it's the life. Every chimpanzee in a safari have it for free. It doesn't have to buy her a drink, doesn't have to put perfume, doesn't have to fix his body in a gym for 10 years, maybe she will like him better, doesn't have to, doesn't have to worry, doesn't have to fix his hair. Every female he meets in a jungle, right away she becomes his girlfriend. Well, that's the problem. They have a baby, doesn't have to raise him 20 years, $1 million, send him to college after 20 years. He wants to eat now. I come home sometimes 2-3 o'clock at night. Usually that's the time I get home after the lectures. Because the lecture is only the little part of the evening. What happened after, it's all the people, you have to talk, you have to convince them to start keeping, problem, marriage issue, children issue, drug issues, depression issues. People need someone to help them. That's usually what takes sometimes into the night. So I get home, what do I see? The squirrels, I don't know, you have squirrels here?
Yeah.
So the squirrels, they like to rip the garbage bags. And I see mamash, a great menu on the driveway. Chinese, Italian, Persian food, gefilte fish. They mixed. They got confused. The squirrels, they don't know what to eat. You see all the bones, everything. They eat from here, from there. All the cats and the squirrels in our family, in our neighborhood, are triple than the average. Why? They know over there the garbage is not locked. The Mizrachi offer free food, 5 different menus for free every night. So you say, wait a minute, I don't want to eat from the garbage. What kind of a great life? You describe that their life is paradise. Imagine I have to find some Chinese leftover in the garbage. You don't want it because you have common sense. You have logic, human logic. You have divine traits such as shame and things like this. They don't have this. The squirrel doesn't feel miserable that he eats the bones or the dog or the cat. They feel very lucky. They are happy, kemotze shalal rav, like they found a treasure. So they don't have to worry. They don't have to kill themselves. Their life is much better. So what are we better than them? The Torah say one thing, the soul, the divine soul, that will be judged. So everybody asks, what kind of advantage is this to be judged? The answer is, to be judged, the coin has two sides, positive and negative. You only focus on the negative. Yeah, to be judged is, God forbid, to get punishments. No, not necessarily. Din v'cheshbon in the Torah means two things. One is judgment, which means what we call in Hebrew, psak din. And then there's gzar din. First, you're guilty or not, by what percentage? You're 70% not guilty, 30% guilty. Depends what you did good, what you did wrong. Or the other way around. And now we're going to pay you. Payments could be receiving something or taking from you something. Depend what you owe or what we owe you. This is the calculation. Very simple calculation. You work for me X amount of time on a project. You work X amount of hours today. You work sometimes harder than the other days. The boss calculate and he gives you what you deserve with a bonus. Why? You were very good. You're sincere. You came on time. You gave your life on a job. So he gives you an extra bonus. People in Wall Street, their bonus is what more than what they make the entire year in New York. I don't know how it makes sense, but that's what it is. They live off the bonus. The salary hardly pay their expenses. They all wait for the end of the year, 100,000 bonus, 150,000 bonus. That's really what they put on the side. So why the bonus? Because they give you based on if you were a very good employee, they want to encourage the employees to give their life to the business. So they know the better you are, the better the bonus is going to be. That's very simple. Same thing the Torah is. The Torah said that the person has a choice. It's not an animal. But I always said, the Torah did not say that we have a free choice. The Torah only say we have a choice. What's the difference between choice and free choice? So there's a massive difference. Why? When I say to you, come to work for me, I'll pay you. Don't come, it's your problem. Stay what you are. That's a free choice. You get up in the morning, you're not in a mood to come to work, you stay in bed. Nothing happened to you. If you had $1,000 in your bank account, you left with $1,000. Nobody punched you, nobody dragged you, nobody spoke anything against you. You stay in your bed to sleep. But if I say to you, come to me to work, and if you don't come, I will penalize you $100 for every day you don't come. So now you get up in the morning. Your real decision was depressing day, cold. What am I gonna go now to work in this day? Better not to go. No. Then in the second thought, I'm gonna lose $100. Oh, okay, wait. You get dressed and you go to work. By the end of the day, you make $300 profit. You're very happy you went to work. What really caused you to go to work and make the $300? The threat, the fear from the punishment. The fear from the punishment caused you to do the right thing. That thanks to that, your children will not starve to death. Why? They have a lazy father. He doesn't want to get up to go to work. What made him go to work? The boss told him, if you don't come to work, I'll fire you. You'll lose your job permanently. The fear from getting fired forced him to go to work. But in the end of the year, he fed his wife, he fed his children, he paid his mortgage, finally surviving. So the punishment is something good or it's something bad, is the best thing that can have happened. Because of the human nature is that 99.9% of the people in the world, they get motivated only when they know they have something to lose. I wish it was enough to follow the instruction with profit. But it's not the case. Most people willing to give up the profit that they may work, may make. But when they know there's a price to pay, they change. What's the proof? If Obama would come on a television and say, ladies and gentlemen, we have an argument with the police going on a strike tonight at midnight. 24 hours, no police. No police, no courts, everyone goes, the justice system is going on strike. Whatever happened in the next 24 hours cannot be brought to justice. Please watch your homes, watch your cars, be safe. There's no police to protect you, there's no court. And the interview is over. What do you think would happen after that announcement? You tell me, no? Use your imagination. What do you think would happen to the world? I mean, to America. What would happen?
Chaos.
Collapse. I tell you what would happen. The whole world will be over. Not only America. The whole world. You ask me how? How can it be? I'll tell you. The Gemara say, Ilmale, always respect the governments and the kingdom. Why? If they would not be around, people will eat each other alive. The reason why people do not kill each other on a hourly basis is because they're afraid of the police and the jail and the kingdom and the electric chair. If you cancel that, the Gemara say, everyone has at least 2-3 enemies. So since there's no punishment, let me go clean them from the face of the earth. That's how half of the world would think. Even if the other half is decent people and they're not planning to kill anyone, out of self-protection, they'll have to shoot back. So everyone would start killing each other. The stock market in New York would collapse. All the wealthy people in Europe and all over the world and in the East that invest trillions of dollars in the stock market get wiped out. People start killing each other. And what would happen when people are desperate? 2 or 3 Russians that have a little bit l'chaim, they press the buttons, atomic bomb, United States retaliate, Pakistan jump in a party, and within 24 hours, the world is over. And you think it's a joke? That's exactly what would happen. You cancel the police one day, everyone has somebody that he must take revenge against. He insulted him, he fired him, he's the reason why I got divorced, he's the reason why I got sick, that doctor killed my son, this, that, oof, there's a list of enemies. Oh, it's a great opportunity, 24 hours, shooting on the street, fire, bombs. Just imagine what the Muslim terrorists would do for the 24 hours in the United States. That will be the end of the world, the end of everything. So the point is like this. The Torah says we have one advantage, and the advantage is that in the end we're going to be judged. Everyone automatically focusing on how much we have to lose. Why nobody focus on how much we have to gain? In case you didn't know, here is what the Torah say will be the reward of a righteous Jew in the moment that he leaves this world. Here is the reward. Listen please carefully to what I say. Maybe it will give you a huge push in your life as a Jew that try to keep the mitzvot. The Torah says, if you take all the pleasure of all the people who lived in this world from day one, from the day Hashem created this world, until the day the world will be finished, thousands of years of billions and billions and billions of people in generation after generation, it's probably more than 100 billion people if you add all the generations together, and now an average life of a person is 70, 80 years, so let's say 75. So 75 years of pleasure. What's a person consider as pleasure? Physical pleasure. Food, sport, money, jewelry, a relationship, whatever you can think of, dancing, music, well, you add, there's about 20, 30 things that people are after in their lifetime, and usually every once in a while they get a little bit from each, one day vacation, 1 hour pleasure, a movie, a game, sport, swimming, camp, tennis, and everything together. In a life of 75 years, how much from the 75 years is really pleasure? Maybe 1 year. 1 year. If you add all the moments together. Not even, well, what is it, 2% from the person's life. Most people, even the wealthiest, they're busy with the work, with stress, with courts, with lawyers, with meeting, getting up, traffic, a lot of headache. It's not 100% pure pleasure. There's a lot of aggravation to everyone. So now, let's say a 1 year. So take 100 billion people. Multiply by 1 year of pure pleasure after you got rid of all the aggravation, you take all the pleasure together. 100 billion approximately. I just want to give you an idea. Don't hold me now by the numbers, just to get the concept here. 100 billion people multiply by 1 year of pleasure, it's 100 billion years of pleasure. Who would sign on it right now? That if one day you die as a religious Jew and kept the Torah and the mitzvot to the maximum ability you can, that you're going to get 100 billion years of pleasure thanks to keeping mitzvot for 40, 50 years that you live here, from bar mitzvah until you die. Fair price for keeping Shabbat, eating good meat and sleeping a little bit and listening to the chazan singing in a shul, such a hard job. For that, you're going to get 100 billion years of pleasure, is it fair deal or no? What do you think? That's not even the beginning of the reward. Listen carefully. The Torah says like this, if you take all the pleasure of all the people, of all the generations, from day one until the end of their life, from the time the world was created until the world will end, it will not be equal. So the reward of a religious Jew, real one, not like many fake ones, the real one, the ones who really give their life for the truth, it will not be equal to the 1 hour reward in the afterlife. 1 hour, first hour that Hashem will put the soul in a place that received the pleasure that He promised to the righteous souls, will be already greater pleasure than all the people in the world from day one until the world end, all their pleasure combined. Where does it say it in the Torah? Yafa sha'a achat shel korat ruach ba'olam haba mikol chaye ha'olam hazeh. 1 hour of pleasure and satisfaction in the afterlife is already greater than this entire world combined. You understand what we're talking here about here or no? If a person works 7 years and killed himself and finally saved $100 million, after killing himself, running after money like crazy, day after day, night after night, 7 days a week, so much aggravation, finally 70 and he has $100 million. And now, God forbid, the doctor told him, Mr. X, we have bad news. You're a sick person. We'll give you maybe 2 weeks to live, 2 or 3 weeks. Come, we want to explain to you what we found in the MRI, in a CAT scan. Come here. So he's very depressed now. Of course, he's not going to smile. He was about to start eating his steak. They just served him a beautiful 2-pound steak. And he got that news, he threw the steak to the garbage. His beautiful blue label whiskey was ready to go. Throw it to the garbage. Doesn't care about it. The lawyer is calling him. There's $1 million delayed in a deal. Doesn't even care to answer him back. What is he thinking right now? How do I get my life back? That's all he's thinking about. Doesn't care about his buildings anymore. This tenant didn't pay. The deal in Africa went through. None of these things mean anything to him. Before the phone call, everything was so important. One tenant didn't pay $1,000. He's calling the lawyer like crazy. $100 million cash. The $1,000 delayed, killing him. I know a lot of people like this. I know a guy made $8 million on a deal. And then one teenage fooled him for $30,000. And he called me to meet with me. I didn't know what the problem is. And he sat with me for 1 hour. And you should see how he was holding his tears. He almost cried tears that he lost to this crook. $30,000, and he made on one deal $8 million. He probably made $100 million on other deals. Very big shot in business. The $30,000 made him so miserable that he was holding his tears, was sitting in front of me. So what do you see? Doesn't matter how much you have. You look at how much you lost, how much you could have had. The evil inclination never lets you rest in peace. The Gemara says, he has 100, he wants 200. He has 200, he wants right away 400. He will never stop being hungry for it. Can be 90 years old, he's still planning the next real estate project. He called his son, buy that hill, we clean all the trees, we'll make 3 beautiful buildings. Well, he says, father, you're 90 years old, relax. No, it's a great opportunity. Make the meeting, make the phone call. I see it all the time. People that should have rest now, sit in yeshiva, learn, relax, enjoy life. No, there's not one moment of rest, all the time. So now, he's in a hospital now, and he's desperate. All of a sudden, there's a Chinese doctor showed up. He comes, says, hello, my name is Mr. Li. I just came on a special plane from China. Nobody here in America knows me, but I'm a doctor in China. And he shows him a little glass like this. He says, see, this is the cure for your disease. You drink it, it kills all the cancer. In 3 hours, you're healthy. They don't know about this medicine in America. It's not approved by the FDA. But I guarantee you, you drink it, 3 hours, you're a clean person. how long you're going to live. You're not exactly a teenager. You know, you're 70 years old. So, you know, every day you live, it's already a good luck. But the cancer is gone. So the Jew, his eyes lit up like, wow, give it to me. Thank you. The guy's, wait. Don't jump too fast. We did an exam. We check how much money you have. We saw that you have $100 million. So please, if you sign here and here and here and here, you know, the lawyer comes right away. The lawyer is ready with all the papers. We would leave you $1 million. You can leave, don't worry, you won't starve. You're 70, it will be enough for a few years to live until you leave this world. We leave you $1 million, $99 million you wire to our account in China. And you get up and no cancer. Or you rather die, it's up to you. I believe that most of the people, if not all, when they know they're about to die, they would buy the medicine. And the Chinese doctor tells you, I just want you to know, nobody knows the secrets of what I put here. It didn't even cost me a dollar to make it. It's like putting salt on his wounds. It didn't even cost me a dollar. But no one knows the secret. You gotta pay for it. So now what do you think? Most likely you would pay because people don't wanna leave this world. So you would pay the money. So here comes the question. This is an absurd. God gives a person 70, 80 years of life. He's free to do whatever he wants. He gave us Torah. Torah in Hebrew means instructions. What does the Torah say? Re'eh anochi noten lifnechem hayom. See what I'm giving you today. I'm giving you the life and the good, the bad and the death, and you should choose the life, which means you can choose the death. But the death doesn't come right away. Hashem said to Adam, you see this tree? Don't touch it. The day you eat from the tree, you'll die. He ate from the tree and he lived 930 years after, and then he died. Why didn't he die immediately? The Torah says, if you would not eat from this tree, you would live forever. After you ate from the tree, the rules in the creation changed. Now you're going to die. You cannot stay here forever. Why? The next step was that you eat from the tree of life. You have to understand a little bit in case you're confused. When the world was created, the Torah said that Hashem told Adam that he lives in Gan Eden, Garden of Eden, and he has to watch the garden and enjoy from it, and he's the boss. And then after he sinned, the Torah said that he kicked him out of Garden of Eden. Now this Garden of Eden, where was it? Was it in this world? Was it in a different planet? Where was it? Anybody found that place in the world? Furthermore, when you read the description of how the world was created, how Hashem created the world, and he tells you that there are rivers and they split to two and then to four, and they describe the planet, the creation, the world doesn't look like the Torah described. And we cannot come and say the Torah has a mistake, because if you want to say the Torah has a mistake, then we have to say that a human being wrote the Torah. God forbid. But every foolish human being that I know would not make such a mistake. For instance, he knows that the description in the Torah has nothing to do with the world. The world has a map. And what the Torah says, it's not feeding the map of the world. So you don't need to be God to know this. Even a person knows it. So how come there is supposedly a mistake? The answer is there's no mistake. The world changed. When Hashem created the world, there was only one continent, if you read in the words. There was land and water. That's it. 1,500 years after, people were big criminals, big sinners. And Hashem said, I gave the people the choice to be righteous or wicked. All of them became wicked except Noah. One person is righteous. Everybody else, millions of people are wicked. So what's the solution? I have to restart my world. It's not going anywhere. Yes, I gave them free choice, but they destroyed the world. They destroyed nature. They destroyed the animal. What they do, horrible things. So what's the solution? I have to wipe them out from the face of the earth and start a new world. And I have to purify the world with water. Water in the Torah, it's a sign of purity. That's why we go in a mikveh, we take the pots that we buy, we put them in a mikveh. Why? Because the Torah says, et ruach atuma ha'avir min ha'aretz. Tuma, impurity, it's a ruach, it's a spirit. Spirit cannot enter water. When a person goes in a water, the impurity that was on his body, it's a spirit. It comes out. He goes in 1 second, in. One hair of his head stayed out of the water. The spirit holds to that hair. It doesn't go away from the body. That's why when they convert to Judaism, after the circumcision and all the process of learning and the test and all that, the final step is to see that they go into the mikveh. The three rabbis, the dayanim, on a bed din, they come to check carefully to make sure that his entire body is inside. And if there's a doubt, I do it sometimes in a bed din in New York. If there's a doubt, we tell them go again inside. Why? God forbid, if one little tiny finger stayed out or one hair stayed out, he will be a non-Jew all his life. He doesn't become a Jew. The only way he can be a Jew is going in the water, Chris, and come out Yosef. And the only way it can happen, the only way it can happen is when he went completely in Chris. If a little bit from Chris stay outside, he come out Chris. Do you believe such a thing? One tiny thing left out of the water, and he did not get the extra soul that he gets in a time of conversion. Can you believe such a thing? Unbelievable. Why? The only way to do it is the proper way. So now, Hashem purified the world. When was that? 4,200 years ago. 40 days rain, the whole world is covered with water, and scientists, archaeologists, I should say, they found the ark, Noah's ark. Noah's ark was found. How long is the ark? Do you know? Over here in London, people like football. What they call in America soccer. The field is 100 meter. Noah's ark is 1.5 of this field. Add another half to the soccer field. That's how long the boat was. Right? And 30 meter wide. And 15 meter height. 15. Like three floor. 5 meter, 5 and 5. So it's a very big cruise boat. No? Guess where it was found? On a very high mountain next to Turkey, Are Ararat, as the Torah says. That's when the Torah says, the ark, rested. What's happened? I explain to you. When they make big boats like this, when do they make them? On the beach. You cannot make it in the middle of London and then drive all the way 4 hours to the beach with such a big boat. How exactly are you going to make the turns? Cannot move it. You must make these huge, gigantic boats right by the water. That as soon as the job is done, all you have to do is to push them into the water. Otherwise, it's a torture to carry such a thing. It's thousands of tons. How are you going to bring it to the water? It's impossible. You must make it by the water. So now, in order for you to make such a boat, let's say Noah, there was no water yet because God told him he's going to bring flood to the world. So he built it somewhere. Somewhere he built it. And then, after he finished, the boat was found in a very high mountain, more than 1 kilometer height from the ocean level, very high. Nobody makes boat in such mountains. It's very difficult to go there to make a boat. How did the boat arrive there? Only one explanation, that the world was covered with water, like the Torah say, and it was going all over, and then it started to dry. And the moment it dried to a level that the bottom of the boat touched the land, it stuck there. That's it. It was not sailing anymore. And that's where they found it, exactly like the Torah said, that the Teva rested in the mountain of Ararat, exactly over there. After that, the world restarted. The world started again. 4,200 years later, here we are. 900 years approximately after the flood, that's when the Jews received the Torah. What happened before that? The people only had to keep 7 laws, that's it. 7 laws. You should not kill, you should not steal, you should believe in one God, no son, no friend, no brother, no nothing, none of this. You should make yourself a system of police and court and obey the rules. That is not going to be a chaos in every country, as I said before. You should not be an idol worshiper. No sex crimes among the relatives, even to the Gentiles. They're not allowed, right? Which include homosexuality and forbidden relation with animals, which also include by the Gentiles. Also, it's a big sin for them. Some people think only a Jew is not allowed to do these things. The Gentiles also not allowed. And you should not eat any animal before you kill it, which means you can kill the animal in any way you want if you're a non-Jew. You don't have laws how to kill the animal. But you have to make sure before you start cooking the animal that the animal is dead. In the old days, they used to cut parts of the animal and eat them. They just take a part of it and eat. So the Torah says, no, you cannot be cruel to the animal. You have to kill them in any way you want, with a sword, with a rock, whatever you want. Today, how they kill the animals? They electrocute them. What they used to do in Europe, they used to have a rocket gun, and they used to shoot the cows right in the forehead and blow their brain off. And they thought this is the best way to kill them, that they don't suffer. They meant well. They wanted the animals not to suffer. So you blow their brain, they cannot have feelings, because all the feelings come from the brain to the nerve system. Then after a few months, the mad cow disease started. Why? The mad cow disease is something in the brain that once you blow out the brain, it goes to the rest of the body. People started to eat meat in Europe and become sick, and I don't know, it led to a lot of tragedies. It got to a point that in Italy, they sold one piece of meat for $5,000. There's no meat to get. So it was a disaster. So they always said to the Jews, the way you slaughter your animal is very cruel. You cut in the front, and it takes about 2-3 minutes until the cow is moving, it has reflex. You see that the cow is suffering. What kind of a killing is that? It's Sar Baalei Chaim, you're torturing the animals. So the Jews say, it cannot be that we torture the animals, because the Torah said that God told us to be very sensitive to the animal feelings. You have to feed your animal before you eat yourself. It's a law in a book of law, in a Shulchan Aruch. You cannot sit to eat before you feed your animals. Not only that, you cannot make any pain to the animal. Even when you kill the animal, the Torah told you to kill the animals in a way. If you need them, if you need to use whatever they supply, you have to kill them by a certain way that they don't suffer. And soon I'll explain what does it mean not to suffer. Any kind of torturing animals, it's against the Torah. The Torah has a very, very strong feelings for them. Not only that, the dogs that did not bark when the Jews came out of Egypt, once a year we give them, you know, all kinds of gifts, food, whatever, right? As appreciation for the dogs for not turning us into the Egyptians. There's all kinds of laws in the Torah that it's animal rights. Animal rights. So now how can it be that the Torah would give it a cruel execution to those animals if the Torah is very sensitive to their feelings? The answer is, the only way the animals don't suffer is the way the Torah said. Why? The non-Jews, they came to complain to the Jews that the slaughtering is not good. Why the animal suffer? They claim that the animal has two cords that transfer blood to the brain from the front and two reserve ones in the back. So you, the Jews, you take the knife, you make the knife very sharp, you don't make bumps in the knife because you worry that the animal won't suffer, because if there's a bump, the pain is much harder. So you do all these things, but then you cut only the front, and then there's two reserve cords that continue to supply blood to the brain for another few minutes. So the animal suffer. So the Jews told them, there's only one thing you did not check correctly. These laws of the two reserve cords in the back of the neck is only true to the non-kosher animals. The list of the kosher animals in the Torah have only two cords in the front. Check. None of them has reserve. You know better than God how to kill the animals that they don't suffer? Go and check. The sheep, the cows, they all have only two. They didn't have what to answer. How they kill the animals? They put cows on a metal floor and they raise the voltage to 500 and they electrocute them. Some Jews say to me, Rabbi, the non-kosher meat is a lot juicier. What happened? Ah, some people said 19 years I speak and something like this never happened. The dog wants to hear Divrei Torah, he comes right under
here. What you said about in Egypt.
Yeah, he heard about it. As soon as I said the dogs in Egypt, we have to give them a gift, the dog showed up. Can you believe such a thing? Ah, no? Perfect timing or no? You heard about the dog? All right, let's go back. That's funny. All right, anyway. One person told me, Rabbi, but the non-kosher meat is much juicier. It's delicious. So I said to him, let me explain to you, in case you're right, why you're right. I said to him, after they electrocute the cows, they don't right away take care of all of them. They go one by one. Some of them lay there for three, four hours, and all the urine and the blood in the stomach of the cow begin to absorb inside the rest of the organs, right? It's like marinated in many liters of blood and urine. What do you think happens? It's not like by Judaism when they slaughter the cow, right away they open it, they split it to half, they put tons of salt, and all the blood comes out. All the blood, the urine, all the liquids comes right away out of the meat. That's a condition to make it kosher. If you're not doing it, within 72 hours, it's too late after that. You cannot do it. You have to put lots of salt, and it takes away all the dirt, all the liquid. So by then, they don't do it. So it gets marinated. By the time they take the skin off, by the time they open it, by the time they cut it to steaks, it's marinated sometimes 10, 20 hours inside this dirt. And then you eat a juicy steak in McDonald's or whatever you go over there. Not you, those who do it. And what happened to them? Wow, it's so juicy. Of course it's juicy. It's marinated in urine of the cow. Think again before you eat non-kosher. Not you, whoever does. You understand? So what am I saying here? Many people would do things out of ignorance. If they only know why, they'll think a million times before. So the non-Jews are allowed to eat nevelot. Nevela means you shot the deer and you then later eat it. No problem. You stab it and you eat it. You electrocute it and you eat it. It's not a sin for the goyim. They're allowed. Jews are not allowed to eat nevelot. And there's something that's called trefot. There's some defect in the animal, in the lung. There's a hole in the lung, or something in the shechita did not go right. Or the person who slaughtered it was a non-kosher Jew, according to the law. Not every Jew is shechita, is kosher. Some Jews that violated some rules of the Torah, they exclude themselves from Judaism until they make repentance. Once they make repentance, they welcome back. But as long as they violate some major rules, if they slaughter an animal, even if they do it 100% according to the laws of the Torah, with the right knife, in the right place, and the animal was perfectly complete, everything, but because this person is violating some of the major rules of the Torah, the animal is not kosher. No one is allowed to eat from it. Shechitato nevela, Rambam writes in Ilchot Shechita, and in Shulchan Aruch, cannot eat from him. So what do we see here? It's not enough only to do it 100% according to the law. It's not enough that the animal will be perfect according to the law. It also depends who does it. The person that does it can make it not kosher. Same thing mezuzah. You can look at a beautiful mezuzah. Wow, what a handwriting. Amazing, like a print. But the person who wrote it was an impure person, wicked Jew, what the halakha called wicked. This mezuzah is not kosher, he cannot use it. 100%. So what do we see here? That who are you can create purity or impurity. Depends who the person that does it. I'll give you another example. If a Kohen, you give him a sacrifice in the time of the Holy Temple, the Beit HaMikdash, and the Kohen has a bad thought or the wrong thought about the Korban, Once he sacrificed it, you brought that Korban A, sacrifice A, and he thought about B. And made the Korban non-kosher. The thought of the Kohen made the entire sacrifice pasul. Yom Kippur, the Kohen enters Kodesh HaKodashim once a year to pray for the entire nation of Israel. In the middle of praying, which is only a few minutes, the whole ceremony, they used to tie a rope to his leg because no one is allowed to enter there. So what happens if he dies inside? The only way to get him out is to pull the rope. How a Kohen will die? That 5 minutes, the whole year that he goes inside Kodesh Hashim, over there is going to die? The answer, yes. Hundreds die like that. Why? If he has one thought that is not connected to the service of Yom Kippur in inside Kodesh HaKodashim, one, not dirty thought, not a thought of a sin, a thought that is not connected to the mitzvah, he falls and dies immediately. And they pull him out with a rope. The Gemara say, Bet HaMikdash HaSheni, the second temple, there was hundreds of Kohanim. Only 4 or 5, if I remember correctly, were kosher. All the other ones, the Gemara say, did not finish the year in Keuna. They did not stay Kohen Gadol even 1 year. Why? They are not worthy. Only 4 of them. One, Shimon, was Kohen, I think, 40 years. Ishmael ben Favi, 12 years. The Gemara brings, he was 12 years. He was 40 years altogether. But the rest, according to the calculation, did not finish 12 months. The second temple. You know, why is it? The first temple, there was in a much higher level and with higher miracles. By the second temple, it was already lower level. Also, it was destroyed on Sinat Chinam. Jewish people, religious Jews, everyone was religious almost those days, almost everyone. And the ones who were not religious never dared to show it in public. In Halakha, they always speak about someone who does sins in public, befaresia, in public. Today, everyone does in public. If you sinner, you sinner everywhere. I never met a person that makes sins only when he hides in his house. Whatever he does everywhere. It's not embarrassed from anyone. But in the old days, someone who wanted to sin had to hide. If once in a blue moon someone dared to do it on the street, that was like a shocking thing. When I was a kid in Israel, no one could drive on Yom Kippur. No one. Not like today, people drive and... If you drove one step out of your home, you drove 100 meters, your entire windows and windshield, everything will be smashed to pieces. Secular people would pick up rocks and throw and break all the glasses in a car. Why? How dare you drive in Yom Kippur? The secular people who used to do it, they did not know ever in their life that to violate Shabbat is a lot worse than to violate Kippur. So they are violating every Shabbat, but Yom Kippur, it's very holy for them. It is, it's a holy day. But no one ever bothered to tell them ever in elementary school or high school that Shabbat is in a much higher level. Shabbat is an eternal covenant between the Jewish nation to God. Eternal covenant. Anybody here can understand the meaning eternal covenant? Do you know what it means, eternal? Eternal means 1,000, hundreds of billions and millions of trillions of years. It's not even the beginning. That means eternal covenant. Eternal covenant not only in the world here, 6,000 years. Forever and ever. It's in this world and also in the afterworld. When the soul goes up to the upper worlds. This will be the final and eternal covenant forever and ever. Even when the world is over. And those of us who will go to heaven and the rest will not make it there. What will always make the connection between us and Hashem is this Shabbat. Shabbat is the eternal. What do we say in a Kiddush? The nation of Israel keep Shabbat. To do Shabbat, an eternal covenant between me and the nation of Israel, it's a sign for eternity. That's what keeps the connection between us. You want me? You must keep the covenant. You don't want to keep the covenant. Don't come to me to complain ever. You cut yourself from me. I didn't cut you from me. I reached my arm to you. Come, son. Shake my hand. Let's make a tight covenant between you and I. So what is the sun doing? Get out of here. Just give me oxygen, give me food, give me water, give me a nice house, give me 2-3 cars, give me $5 million cash in my bank account, give me children, give me health. And whatever I say, don't dare not to do. You heard me? But I'm not going to do anything for you. This is what we are sometimes. Give me this, give me that, give me, give me, give me, give me, give me. Sometimes I'm embarrassed. I read in a Siddur, give us this, give us this. I say, I have to pray, what can I do? But really, if it was up to me, I would be embarrassed to ask. How much he does for us, how much we do for him. There's nothing to compare. And these of people who keep some mitzvot. Now, some people do not keep one mitzvah a month. Nothing. And if they kept accidentally a mitzvah, and you tell them, oh, you know, you're keeping a mitzvah, then they're going to stop. Why? Yeah, because they don't want anything to do with him. I know people like this. Please don't preach to me about religion. They're allergic to religion. Rabbi Akiva was like this. Rabbi Akiva, before he made repentance, he said, this is in the Gemara, he said, when I used to see a Talmid Chacham, when I used to see a rabbi, you know what I had in my mind? I want to bite him like the bite of the donkey. So the Gemara said, why not the bite of a dog? Dogs are biting. Donkeys usually don't bite, hardly ever. Why Rabbi Akiva emphasized a bite of a donkey, not a regular bite of a dog? Why? When a dog bites, it makes a few holes in the skin, it makes a damage, that's it. When the donkey bites, it does not leave the bone complete. The bone becomes powder. It's like grinding the bones. A person will never have a bone anymore. A bite of a donkey is so strong that once a person got bitten, that's it. His hand or whatever it was done, it's done forever. So Rabbi Akiva is telling you not only to bite the rabbis, to bite them in such a way to destroy them. And what happened in the end? He became the greatest Jew in history. You believe such a thing? What a turnaround. From being a religion hater, for hoping to buy the rabbis and destroy them, he became the greatest Jew in history. And I know what you're thinking of. What do you mean, the greatest Jew? Moshe Rabbeinu. He was bigger than Moshe Rabbeinu. Why? Moshe Rabbeinu got everything from Hashem on a gold platter. Here, take everything. The whole Torah, inserted a disc. The Gemara says Hashem would tell Moshe, and Moshe forgets. Tells him again, he forgets again. He gave him all the Torah in a gift. Moshe was very righteous, was very humble. He gave a lot, he did a lot. Hashem loved him, the Torah named after him. Everything is fine. Rabbi Akiva achieved that level on his own. It's a big difference. You were zero, and you became 100. Now, I can make you 100 if I have the power and I turn you from 0 to 100 in a minute. And your friend worked 80 years to get to 100. Who do you appreciate more? Who do you appreciate more? A kid that his parents gave him his business ready to go and he makes millions? Or someone who made it from 0? He went, he started to be a waiter and he saved a little money and he invested and he made. And after 10 years, he built an empire. Who people appreciate more? A prince, a spoiled prince, that his father bought him a $3 million factory, and now he's made it into $100 million, but his father gave him all the money, or someone who went from zero. His parents didn't have money, and he worked, and he did, and he ran, and he made an empire on his own. Who people appreciate more? Who? Anybody appreciate more the kid that his father gave him everything?
No? Have different qualities. Both have different
madrigals. Different madrigals. But who deserves more appreciation? Someone who did it from zero on his own or someone who got it ready? Right? Everybody understands. Someone who worked for it. Just by the way, you should know that it's only true in this fake world. In the real world, it doesn't really matter how you made your money. Whether you earned it or whether someone gave it to you as a gift or whether you found it on the street or whether your parents gave it to you. It's all from God anyway, regardless who gave it to you. God wanted you to have it one way or the other because this is what he wanted you to have for your test in life. Therefore, it doesn't really matter. I'll give you an example of what I mean. In this world, there are two ways to make money. One is to go and work and kill yourself. A day, another day, another day, college, degrees, applying here, applying there, working extra shifts, working 7 days a week. Thinking, the more I work, the more I kill myself, the more I make. Makes sense to some people. Then there's another way. What's the other way to make money? Is to say, God, I read in your Torah, you put me here, you gave me life, and you're going to judge me when I die. That's what I know for sure. You also wrote in the Torah that everything that we have comes from you. You also wrote in the Torah that the more we perform and do what you want, the more you will give us. You also wrote in the Torah that if we'll conduct business honestly and we don't steal and we don't cheat and da-da-da-da-da, you will give us more and the money that we make will be more blessed. You also wrote in the Torah that money does not come from work. Most people don't know it. You wrote in the Torah, money comes from you, not from work. Which means, how you can make money if you don't work? The Torah say, money comes from me. Whether you work, whether you not work, when you're handicapped, you sit on a wheelchair, you cannot work, money comes from me. And all the people who goes to work every day, they get angry. They say, what do you mean money comes from me? If I wouldn't work, if I wouldn't kill myself, I wouldn't go to college, I wouldn't be the lawyer that I am. I wouldn't be the judge that I am. How? What would I be? I wouldn't have what to eat if I didn't have education. If I don't kill myself every day in traffic, running, working, trying, how my family have money? The answer is, you would have the same amount of money. Depend. The Torah say, the more you develop your confidence in God, the easier your money will come to you. This is the formula. Most people in the world do not know it or knows about it, but do not try to get to this level. The Torah says, have confidence in me. I'm giving you bread to eat today from heaven, man. You see in your own eyes, man is falling every day like popcorn, like snow. You pick it up from the floor and you eat. You don't have to work, you don't have to cook, you don't have to anything. Everyone gets food. Don't save for tomorrow. Eat it today, enjoy. Don't leave some in a jar. Tomorrow, trust me. I'll take care of you also tomorrow. I have no limitation. Some people didn't trust him. They put in a jar. The Torah say the next day it all became worms. Why? Why does he care? Okay, I don't trust you. I'm worried that you're not going to give me bread tomorrow, so I left a little bit for tomorrow. Why are you so upset? Apparently, when we do not have faith and believe in him, he gets very angry from us, very upset from us, very disappointed from us. Why? The Torah say, I'm your father. I am taking care of you. I'm feeding you. I'm feeding the whole world from a little lice to the biggest animal, ram. It's like the size of a dinosaur. You worry that I won't feed you? I feed the idol worshippers that make me so angry every day, bowing down to their foolish idols. I give them money. I give them homes. I give them everything. You, my son, who I ask you to learn Torah and to be righteous, I won't feed you for doing what I want. I feed the thieves. I won't feed someone who does not steal. No matter how you look at that logically, why wouldn't I feed you? I feed the worst people in the world. I feed the animals. I feed the enemies of Israel. I fed the Nazis. I fed the Egyptians. I fed the Philistines. I fed the worst people in the history. What makes you think that you are my son, my Jew, my little Jew, that I made a covenant with you? I have limitation to feed you. I can feed you as much as you want. Only one thing I want from you. To trust me that I will do for you. That's what we say every day. We don't pay attention. Yichazdecha Hashem aleinu, kaasher ichalnu lach. Chesed means kindness, mercy. Your kindness and mercy on us should be according to how much we hope for it. If I hope for a 10%, I'll get 10% of what he wants to give me. If I hope and trust him 50%, he'll give me 50% of my budget. If I trust him 80%, he'll give me 80% of my budget. If I trust him 100%, I don't have to worry about money. Money comes constantly, but all the time. Nothing to worry about. I'll give you an example. The stipler was the father of Rabbi Chaim Kanievsky. He, about 40 years ago, he wrote a book. The book was ready in handwriting. Now he needed to print it. He needed 7,000 lirot, like $7,000 today, 40 years ago. One person walked in and said, Rabbi, I heard that you're looking for a sponsor for your book. So he told him, Rav Yaakov Kanievsky, he told him, I already managed, thank you. And he was hoping that someone will give him. It was very poor days in Israel, very poor days. We're talking long, long time ago. So he said, and his son, Rav Chaim, oh, actually it's much more than 40 years because Rav Chaim is about 80 something today. He was a kid in those days. So we're talking at least 65 years ago, that story. Maybe before Israel became a state, when the British were in control there. So he said to him, I already managed. And the person, the wealthy person went out. And there was hardly any wealthy person in Israel. People were standing online by the British. They used to give food stamps. They give you one bag of flour. There's nothing to eat. My father was born in Israel. He told me, I was a kid. We didn't have what to eat. And they put curfews. The British used to put curfews all the time. So I was the little kid. They used to send me to go try to get some food on the street somewhere. So I used to run left and right because they used to shoot to my legs in the time of the curfew. My father was telling me as a kid, he had to run left, right, and they shoot. They try to hit the legs, you know, or to scare him or whatever the case was. This is how bad those days were. So the stipler told the person, I managed already. And he left. So the little Chaim, he said to him, today is the biggest rabbi in the world, his son. So he said to him, Abba, I don't understand. You just told me an hour ago that you're hoping Hashem would send someone to sponsor your book. Here, Hashem just sent you someone. Why you told him you managed? He told him, this person is not kosher. I don't want to take his money. Bezrat Hashem, Hashem will send me another person with kosher money. Why should I take from him? I want you to learn. You have to trust Hashem that nothing will get done in the wrong way. And if it looks like it got done from non-kosher money, there is a price to pay later on. You steal, you can build a home, you can feed your everything. One day you will see that the money you stole not only did not help you, buried you. If you really understand the way the Torah is, soon or later, everyone will pay the price for what they do wrong. Nobody can escape. Nobody. So it looks like all the money you steal, making you a big empire. Think again. In the long run, you see that it wasn't for your own benefits. A minute later, Rav Chaim Kanievsky testified, in a country that no one has what to eat almost, another person walked in, said, Rabbi, is it too late to sponsor your book? He told him, no, the book is ready. He gave him 7,000 lirot. Thank you. He got a bracha and he left. So he said, Rav Chaim Kanievsky, my father looked at me, see, why Hashem send me a corrupted person first that offer me all the money? And then when I say no, he sent right away another person with kosher money. Why? Because he wanted to test me if I trust him or not. If I'll violate the rules and take the stolen money knowing it's not kosher, or I would say, I'd rather not publish my book than publish it against God's will with the non-kosher money, dirty money. Money of rapes, money of murders, money of gambling, money of all kinds of drugs, selling drugs to the children. You know, one time I had a guy, he came to me and he said, I have a lot of money that it's not kosher money. And I already knew his reputation, like he's a drug dealer. He told me, I'm going to give you as much as donations as you want. As much as you want. And you only give me 80% back. I could have made millions of dollars with this guy. You give me, I give you whatever you want. You tell me, write me 100,000, you have to give me 80% back. And you clean my money like this from the non-profit organization. Told him, thank you very much, not interested. Big nisayon. I'm dying to get pennies to sponsor my CDs, to give them out for free. Each CD, dollar, 100 here, 500 there, 200 there. Nothing compared to how much demand. All of a sudden, a person comes and says, you name as much money as you want. Press the button, 100,000, 20,000, 50,000. You give back. So you decide how much you make. He has unlimited amount of money. We can start doing it. Big nisayon. That's not what Hashem wants. Hashem has limitation to send the money from kosher ways. Have to get it from kids that die from drugs or from mafia people. That's not the right way. So Rav Chaim Kanievsky says, his father told him, see, Hashem wanted me to see. If I would take the money, I would take the money from this guy and print my book. Then later I pay the price. Once I passed the test, he gave me the money anyway. It's like this always in life. Some people walk in Shabbat, they want to start keep Shabbat, and their boss put pressure on them. If you're not coming on Shabbat, I fire you. I was now in Florida. There's a nice guy there, but he's one of the people who invited me there. So he was working in a dealership, making $25,000 a month profit. I started to convince him to become Shomer Shabbat, and I told him to move from his place with his family to a place where there's a shul. Where he lived, there's no shul, no nothing. Florida is a very big state. So he told me, if I'll do it, I'm going to get a job, but I'm going to make only $5,000 a month instead of $25,000. I told him, don't worry. Hashem doesn't have limitations. You will go to the new job, maybe a year, maybe two, it could be even five. You would think every month I'm losing $20,000. Don't ever dare to think like this. Whatever you're supposed to make, you make. Don't worry about it. You make it in a kosher way. What do you think the money you used to make working on Shabbat, you think is going to stay by you? Do you think that violating the most important rule in the Torah, not to violate Shabbat, you're violating every week, and you think from that Hashem's going to make you rich? You really think so? Do you think you go against the boss of the world, spit in his face, and he's going to give you a price for it? Think again. Even a simple human being wouldn't give you a price for spitting in his face or violating his instructions. What makes you think the creator of the world, who declare on himself that he's the God of justice, who pays everyone what they deserve, will give a murderer a reward? Or will give a thief a reward? Or will give Michalel Shabbat a reward? Or will give a rapist a reward? What makes you think so? It's against the Torah. The Torah says, you go against me, you'll pay the price. So now what happens if you see someone, his business is open on Shabbat, and he makes fortune on Shabbat? It's a very busy day. What does the Torah say in Parashat Vayetchanan? The last three verses in Parashat Vayetchanan, what does it say? Ani Elkana, I'm the strict God. Meshalem larasha el panav laavido. I pay the wicked person cash to his face to get rid of him. Pay him whatever I owe him right away. Take. And I'm wiping you out from the life of eternity. Rashi writes over there. Pay him ba'olam hazeh, not to give him olam abaf. The question is, why Hashem pays him anything? If he's a violator of the rule, what does it mean, pay your cash to your face? Because every sinner makes a mitzvot. Right? He has mezuzah in his home. It's already a big mitzvah. He eat matzah once a year. He put tefillinis in bar mitzvah for the pictures. You know, the photographer said, listen, bar mitzvah, you have to put tefillin. So he put tefillin, they took pictures, and he put it in his closet. But he put tefillin once in his life. That's already a huge reward. Here and there he ate kosher. Let's see, someone made a business meeting with him, so he had kosher. Once or twice in his life, he made bracha. You know, maybe two friends wanted to kill each other, so he made peace between them. Everyone does some good things. You cannot say, oh, this person only sins. So Hashem said, if you violate Shabbat, if you violate the major laws of the Torah, I am forced to take actions against you, as I said in the Torah. But I owe you for the mitzvot you kept. It's also not fair. I owe you. I promise to pay everyone what they deserve. So what happened? I have to pay you in this life because I'm not giving you afterlife. So I have to pay you here. So if you see a person that does everything wrong against the Torah and is very successful in business, he is the one that we should cry for him the most. Why? If a person violates Shabbat and doesn't make money, struggle, hardly pay the bill, have lots of problems in his business, that's a very good sign. That means Hashem did not wipe him out yet. He's still hoping for him to do tshuva. If Hashem start to pay millions of dollars in his business, then you know, Hashem irachem, that's already moved to the other category. Meshalem la'arasha el panav la'avido. It's verses in the Torah. Don't ever think that I say that. Forget about me. It's me, it's somebody else. We all read from the same Torah. Yeah, there are fakers who modify the Torah because they want donations. You don't get donations when you tell the people the truth in their face. You only get criticism, lashon hara, and the people stab you in the back after you go. You don't really get it. It's okay. If you come from the nation, you're upset. If you don't come for it, you're not upset. You know, you say what the Torah say and you go home. Some people come, they only tell you what you want to hear. You tzaddik, don't worry, everything is fine. You're a Jew, it's already a great thing. You do this, you give charity here and there. You know what it is, you have mezuzah, you're perfectly fine. Don't worry about it. Try a little better, everything will be fine. That's not what the Torah says. It's a lie. If the Torah would say it, of course I would rather give you good news. What speaker wants to say things that the people get upset? He'd rather people laugh and smile and get very happy. Wow, when people are happy, usually the atmosphere gets better. But it's not the truth. What's better, to play in imagination, in fake life, and then in the end it explodes in our face? Or it's better to prepare for the right day accordingly? There's rules. The Torah says you must do tshuva, you must make repentance every day. Why we do 3 times a day confession? Chatati, aviti, pashati. Why? Why 3 times? Why not enough once? Before we go to sleep, we do vidui, finish. Why every day 3 times? Why? The amount of sins that a person does in few hours, it's so enormous that it's already enough to bring him such a huge punishment. So in order for him not to get it, every few hours we do vidui, shachrit, in the morning. Vidui. Mincha, a few hours later, vidui. And when we go to sleep again, that every 6-7 hours, it's not enough to do a lot of sins. If we would do it once a day, it's already 24 hours. 24 hours, we can make 1 million sins. How can you make 1 million sins in 24 hours? Who knows? How can you make 1 million sins in 24 hours? That means you make more than one sin every second. How can it be? What, you have 15 hands? How? The answer is, you put one Lashon Hara comment on Facebook. Already 50 million sins in the next month goes to your account. And if you say it on a kosher person, the sin is triple. It's called Motzi Shem Ra. Lashon Hara is when you say the truth. It's also not allowed. Not allowed to write, I have a friend, his name is Mr. X, and he's a very smelly guy. He doesn't take showers. It's true. You didn't lie. There's no end to your punishment when you die one day. No end for this. Why? Now the whole world knows about this person, what they didn't know before. You messed up his life. You did not lie. Say the truth. It will be very difficult to fix it. You have to go to each person who read it and ask him for mechila. Sorry for saying it. And you have to ask the person to forgive you. And if he doesn't forgive you, you have a very serious problem. What happens if you make lies about him? You say things he never said. You say things he said, but you make it in a way that it sounds negative. You do all kinds of things to destroy him. There's no end. No end to your punishment. In billions of years, it's never going to end because it's affecting so much. It's constantly traveling. How are you going to stop it and bring it back to the beginning point? No end. So here you go. That's what the Gemara says. Yesh adam me'abed olamo berega echad. Person can lose his eternity in 1 second. But a person can only win an eternity in 1 second. How? How? How a person can win in 1 second? Very simple. Before he died, he has $100 million. He writes in his will, I give all my money to save souls. CDs, yeshiva, Torah, books. Hiring people to run to houses, to visit, to show the Torah, to give people reading material. All my money goes to save souls. Right away, everything turns around within weeks. He made so many sins, but now his $100 million started to work for him. Another 1,000 mitzvot, another 1,000, another 5,000, another 10,000. He keeps traveling. He became religious. He puts filin, goes to his account. She became modest, it goes to his account. He put mezuzot, goes to his account. He start to learn Torah, everything goes to his account. He begin to accumulate so many millions of mitzvot, after a short period of time, he turned to positive. You understand? So a person can win in 1 second. So far, any questions for everything I said? So before we finish, mamash, few more minutes, I would just conclude what we focused on. The judgment when we die, it's not a negative thing. It's negative for someone who dies wicked, of course. Nobody wants to be judged for his sins. But it's in our hand to die with a much more mitzvot than negative. We could earn a lot more than to lose in this world. It's in our hand. No one stop us from learning Torah. No one stopping us from giving donation. No one stopping us from dress modestly. No one stopping us for do brachot and to do eat kosher food. It's 100% in our hand. No one stopping us from not speaking Lashon Hara. It's 100% in our hand. Yes, some challenges are difficult. But we could do it. If we really really think about it, there's not one thing in the Torah that we could not do. Some people say, I cannot get up in the morning, Rabbi. You know, I go to sleep 2, 3. How am I going to wake up at 7 to go to shul? How? I wake up at 9, 10. I pray at home. I can't. I sleep late. I have a reason. Baloney. Why? If you come to this person and tell him, okay, I understand it's difficult for you. I'm going to pay you $1,000 for every morning you show up to shul. And he walk all week, he doesn't make $1,000. Every day you show up in shul, I did it to one guy. I told him I found a sponsor. Every day you come to shul, he'll pay you $1,000 cash. He's like, come on, don't fool me. $1,000 for coming to shul? I said to him, yes, you don't believe? Well, I'm not going to lie to you. Tomorrow you'll be before 7 o'clock in the shul. $1,000 cash I give you. And he said, what happened if you don't give me? I said to him, if you come tomorrow and I don't give you, don't ever believe me in anything. Don't come, don't show your face, nothing. Would I take such a risk? So I come tomorrow, 15 times. So I come tomorrow, you give me $1,000 cash. We understand each other. It's 100%. Good thing he didn't tell me, give me something up front. So he said, okay, deal. I say to him, get out of here, you liar. So what do you mean? Why are you fooling me? You just promised me, you're giving me. I said to him, 5 minutes ago, he told me, I can't. As soon as I mentioned $1,000, you became a lion. You would be there at 6 already. Make sure, 15 clocks you put. The alarm, the phone. Why? I'll be the first one over there by mistake. Chas v'shalom, will be traffic maybe. maybe there will be fog. Maybe you won't make it. You know, I don't want chances. It's $1,000 every day. So what do you see from this? Everything we can. We just don't want it enough. Of course we can. You can keep Shabbat, you can be fully modest, you can do everything the Torah say. If I will offer you enough reward, right? If you have a billionaire grandpa. I know one kid, his father is one of the richest Jews in the world. So he tried all kinds of things because his grandson went off the derech, became secular. He tried to send him this rabbi, that one, this one, nothing helps. So then he asked me, what do you think I should do? I told him, tell your son that if he's not going to keep mitzvot, you cut him out of the inheritance, and from this moment on, he will not get a penny from the family. He has to go find a job and work and rent himself a place. He told me, are you serious? I said, yes. Tomorrow is going to be Gdol Ador. Don't worry. An hour later, he called me up. He said, okay, listen, grandpa, forget what happened. I'm going to try. Right away, within a week, went back to yeshiva, started to be tzaddik, black hat, everything. Why? He calculated how many millions or hundreds of millions he would lose eventually. So a very, very wealthy family in billions. So the boy realized. So now when he started, I met someone who knows him. I told him, how is your friend doing? He said, well, it's great. He's in steiging, he's learning. So the threat, it looks like you force him. So what's wrong with forcing? Here you go. You saved his eternity and his money. What's the idea was? The idea was, is something bad for him? Now he's very happy that he keeps. Bottom line, everyone can do everything. If you have any questions now in anything, even different topic, now it's the time. If not, remember what I said. The animals are better than us in everything. We only are better in Torah and mitzvot and preparing ourselves for life of eternity, which means Every day we must learn. Even women has to learn every day Torah. Women are not obligated to learn Torah like a man in certain times, but they're definitely obligated to learn Torah. Why? How they know the law of impurity if they will never learn? How do they know what food is kosher and what's not if they don't learn? How do they know the laws of meat and dairy if it got mixed in the kitchen if they don't learn? How do they know the laws of Lashon Hara, what's allowed, what's not allowed, in Shiduch, on making things and all kinds of things if they don't learn? How do they know the law of Shabbat if they don't learn? How do they know the law of modesty if they don't learn? A woman has to learn 20 years in yeshiva to be a righteous woman. 20 years in yeshiva, from morning to night. But they won't do it. So at least they learn an hour or two a day. So how do you learn? The CDs today, Hashem gave us beautiful. In the kitchen, she cut the meat. She's this. She, TorahAnytime.com. DivineInformation.com. Today, we internet, all for free. Put it on the internet. It's working in your kitchen. I have people, I have thousands of women until now. They told me you cannot go one day without your lectures in the kitchen. That's what keeps us in the kitchen. What all day I'm cooking, preparing, cooking for the yeshiva, doing this, that. Instead of talking on the phone, wasting hours with my friends. So what dress did you buy? How much? When I think over there it's cheaper and this, I have to go and clean my wig and that. Oh yeah, you know, my in-laws are coming. I'm very nervous. You know, they're comparing my food to them. My husband like his mind. All this nonsense. Instead of this nonsense, connect. Not me necessarily. Connect anyone you're connected to. Sometimes the soul, he can be a very great, good speaker, but your soul not connected to him. Sometimes the other one is not as good, but you connect with him. He's encouraging you. Whatever, anyone who encourage you, anyone you enjoy to hear. And sometimes it's even the voice. I have a guy in Florida. He told me, if I don't hear your voice at least an hour before I fall asleep, I can't fall asleep. He said, it's already became an addiction. In order for me to sleep, I have to play it, and that's how I cannot fall asleep. So it's even the voice of the speaker. Sometimes it irritates you. Sometimes you like it. Doesn't matter. Don't make excuses. Fine, there's thousands of speakers, and many of them are very good. Find someone you connect to. You know, I have Israelis, they tell me, I say, why you don't come to the shiur? He said, because it's in English. I said, what's the problem? You're 20 years in America, you know English. He said, no, I cannot hear words of Torah in English. I feel like I'm in a church. They can't listen in English. Okay, so fine, in Hebrew. Go to shiurim in Hebrew. Some don't care. Some say, oh, I can't. I mean, all my life I heard Torah only in Hebrew. Now, it doesn't connect with me in English. Some learn Torah in Russian. Some learn Torah in German. The language of the Nazis, they learn Torah in this language. What can you do? They don't know any other language. That's the language they understand. So what are they going to do? They read Hebrew and they don't understand. Same thing to pray, by the way. Many people pray in Hebrew and they don't understand. It's not good. What you have to do is you have to buy Sidur, one side Hebrew, one side your language. If there's none, in English you have, in French you have, in Persian you have, in Russian you have, many languages already, in Spanish you have. There's many languages already translated the Sidurim. If you don't have in your language, for whatever the reason is, so one time at least, you sit with someone to tell you the meaning of the words of the Tfilat Shmona Esrei, of the Shema Israel, the important prayers, and you write with a pencil above every word what it means in your language. After you do it, when you pray in Hebrew, you look at the English words or whatever the language is, and you know what you're saying. And if there is no way that you understand the word for whatever reason, you pray in your own language. It's better. Better you pray to Hashem in your language that it opens up the heart and makes you a connection to Hashem than to be a robot, read words that you don't understand what they mean. You know, like Spanish that don't know English. It's the same letters, Latin. They read, but they don't understand. Imagine they have to pray in English. They read the words and don't understand what they say. So now what's the point? Same thing a Jew. Jew has to connect to Hashem. Also, when you go to shul, the chazan, why it's important that the chazan will know how to sing nice and beautiful? Who cares? Well, you're requesting for Hashem, give us this, give us, give us, give us. You're great, you're great. That's it. Why it's important to be a chazan? Why? Because it opened the hearts of the people. If a chazan sing beautifully, the music, it's waking up the hearts of the people. And while they're praying, sometimes they're crying. The Syrian chazanim in Brooklyn, each one is greater than anyone you can think of. The voices that they have and the way they sing, it's better than to go to any show. You come to shul on Shabbat, you can sit there for 3-4 hours and enjoy the show because they sing so beautifully. However, you go sometimes to shul, when is it going to be over? Mizrat Hashem, there's a lot more to say tonight, but I want to let you go to sleep. The week is starting. So, first of all, thanks again, Josh, for inviting us here to your parents' home. And we have 2 more lectures left. Tomorrow night, what's the topic tomorrow night?
Torah and Derech
Eretz. Very important topic. And Monday night, how to reach real happiness in life. Don't mix that. Tomorrow night is in...
Rav Doron Netzach Israel.
Rabbi Doron Netzach Israel.
Is that in English?
English. In London, you speak English, my friend.
Well, Rabbi Doron, sure, they have lots of Israeli speaking.
Ah, that's why. Okay, good. It has to be in English. It's enough, Even the minority don't speak English, and the majority speaks English.
I don't know.
Okay.
So tomorrow, and also on Monday in Anshei Shalom,
St. John's Wood,
whatever that means. and the school, what's the school? The school on Monday morning, what's the name of that school?
You're speaking in the base and has my name.
If you have kids over there, whatever.
And you're also speaking in Torah Way tomorrow morning.
Torah Way, oh, it's tomorrow morning or Monday morning? Monday morning. You scared me now. All right, thank you very much. Have a great week. We'll see you again, Bezrat Hashem.